Well, thank you very much, Mr. Chairman, and thank you to all of our witnesses for joining us for this hearing today. Before I speak on the hearing, Mr. Chairman, I wanted to mention a few things. And first of all, I just wanted to say I've been in very close contact with local leaders on the ground as families in my home state of Washington and the West Coast are dealing with devastating fires that are wiping out communities and damaging air quality dramatically. And I just want to publicly thank the many courageous first responders and firefighters who are risking their lives to save our families and communities, and let them all know I am committed to doing everything I can to make sure that local fire departments and officials and communities have everything they need to fight these fires and begin this long road to recovery. So thank you for allowing me to say that. And secondly, Mr. Chairman, I want to take a moment to just acknowledge your many decades of leadership on a vast number of issues, including on today's topic, which I know you've always been focused on. Throughout our time in the Senate and our 6 years running this committee together, you've often helped the committee and its members in leading us in very important discussions on critical issues facing families across this country. And I know I speak for all the members when I thank you for the manner in which you have partnered with me to run this committee as we look into issues like name, image, likeness, and so many others. It is easy, especially now, to just go into our respective corners and not have a discussion about big problems that our country's facing. And it demonstrates really your commitment to this institution and the importance of dialogue, that even now you are facilitating bipartisan discussions on topics like this. This committee benefits enormously from your experiences as a governor, as president of the University of Tennessee, and education secretary. And I know January's a ways off, but I want to start off by thanking you for all of your great work on this committee and in the Senate. Mr. Chairman, I have to say our work together really means a lot to me, because while we do have different backgrounds and different perspectives and different styles, you and I and the great members of this committee share a commitment to getting things done for families and communities we represent and for our country. We both want to continue the important role this committee and the Senate play, and we truly will miss you helping drive discussions like the one we're having today. Again and again over the years, you've come to work looking to solve problems, not score political points. So I know I speak for all committee members on both sides of the aisle when I say you will be greatly missed. There's no better proof of your determination to work in a bipartisan way and do whatever it takes to find common ground than the countless bills that we've worked on together. And this committee was successful in passing from the 21st Century Cures Act to the Every Student Succeeds Act to Perkins CTE, as well as a number of bills to address the opioids epidemic. These laws didn't just tackle big issues, they managed to get broad bipartisan support from all of our colleagues, and millions of families for years to come will benefit from your work. So thank you. Now today, I'm glad to have the opportunity to talk about college athletes, which I know is personal to you as a former track and field star. And Mr. Chairman, as you and I have talked about before, the issue of compensating college athletes is something you've long been focused on, and I'm glad we're having this conversation today. I also want to thank Senator Murphy for pushing us to have this discussion today, and to colleagues who are off this committee like Senator Booker for their work and leadership on this issue. This summer, our nation finally began to reckon with police brutality and the pervasiveness of systemic racism in our country, a reality which so many have lived with their entire life. One of the many issues we are overdue to address is the exploitation of college athletes, which has profound racial and economic justice implications. For too long, the $15 billion college sports industry has been a glaring example of economic and racial inequity, one where the majority of athletes in Division I revenue-generating sports are Black, and mostly white coaches and NCAA officials make millions off the labor of young college athletes. Despite the fact that college athletes bring in millions of dollars for colleges each year and stimulates local economies across the country, they are prohibited from receiving a penny in compensation. Now, I know there are people who say a quote, free education is a privilege, or compensating athletes will hinder their education, or paying college athletes will be the end of college sports as we know it. But the, you know, the stories I have heard from many young athletes back in my home state of Washington about the inequity and abuse they've experienced show how our current system exploits young athletes, particularly young athletes of color, and it has to be reformed. I heard from a former all-star Black college athlete in Washington State who, before he went pro, said he had to steal food from the cafeteria and grocery stores because he was not allowed to work and he couldn't afford food. That's a tough thing for someone to share, but he wanted everyone to know just how difficult it can get for so many athletes. There are countless stories of college athletes who had their futures thrown into jeopardy because they got injured and were not guaranteed long-term affordable health care. And in some instances, they might lose their scholarship and their chance at an education. College athletes are struggling to manage their academic course loads and grueling daily schedules filled with workouts, practices, and games, while also facing food and economic insecurity. While the NCAA and member schools enter into billion-dollar media deals, universities invest in luxury facilities, coaches receive million-dollar salaries, and more. That's immoral. We should not accept that. So I urge all my colleagues in the Senate to listen to the experiences of college athletes, particularly college athletes of color in their home states, because once you do, it's impossible to deny that change is needed. There are a lot of ways Congress and other committees can act to protect college athletes' rights, and I want to talk about a few of them. First and foremost, we need to make sure that college athletes are fairly compensated. And an important first step towards that issue is allowing athletes to profit from the use of their name and image and likeness, or NIL. And we have to ensure that all athletes, men and women, get a fair share of the revenue that they help to generate. But fair compensation is just one part of protecting the rights of college athletes, especially now as the COVID pandemic rages on. It's crucial that we establish enforceable health and safety standards. If an athlete gets injured while playing for their college, they should not be expected to deal with the medical or financial fallout on their own. We have to make sure that college athletes are guaranteed affordable health care, and that colleges take responsibility for lifelong health issues related to an injury. And we absolutely need to give college athletes the quality educational opportunities and support they deserve. Too many college athletes are being funneled into easy classes, sometimes even fake ones, simply don't have the time to complete their coursework due to rigorous practice schedules or aren't finishing their degree. And for Black athletes, graduation rates are significantly lower than white athletes. Just 55% of Black male athletes from the Power Five conferences graduate within 6 years, compared to 70% of all college athletes. That's wrong, and it is unacceptable. All college athletes should receive the academic support they need to complete a quality education, and assurances that their scholarships will not be revoked if they're injured. It's clear the status quo isn't working. It only serves those at the top. The NCAA should have addressed these issues long ago, but failed to do it. So Congress must face these challenges head on and offer college athletes solutions that end this current system of exploitation and replace it with a system which values college athletes' voices. So thank you again, Mr. Chairman, as well as to each of our witnesses who we will hear from shortly. Before I close, I just want to say, in addition to these injustices right now, college athletes and their peers are also dealing with a pandemic that has brought enormous uncertainty to higher education. For students and everyone suffering through this pandemic, I just want to note, we cannot wait for weeks or months for another relief package. We have a lot of work to do, a lot of it. So I hope in the days to come, we can finally get started on a serious negotiation to reach an agreement that meets the dire needs we are hearing from our families and the communities we serve. Thank you, Mr. Chairman.